Works for hosting this, and to all of you for coming out on a Tuesday night. So what I wanted to talk to you all tonight about is my Blood Battery series. And so I'm going to share a few works from this series, and it's an ongoing series that I started last year. And I'm going to share some of the concepts that were kind of bouncing around in my head when I made these. So each of these sculptures is a functioning battery. It has copper and zinc electrodes, and I'm using blood as my electrolyte. And then there's also some sort of a small electronic component involved. So I started making these batteries last year, and this idea, though, had been kind of brewing for a while, and I was interested in the idea of blood as a metaphor for identity. And I was curious if the identities and the characteristics that we attribute to blood could be passed on if we use that blood to power a non-human system the way that blood powers a human system. And in order to explain why I was interested in this at all, I need to go back here to this question. So I get this question all the time. And really, when people are asking me this, what they're asking is, what race are you? And the answer is, I'm mixed. So this question, though, is a really weird question if you think about it. What are you? What? This is a question that we ask when we're talking about objects. What is that over there? It's a chair. So you know, one way for me to answer this question would to just say, I'm human. But I assume that the person asking me this question already knows that. And so what they are really asking is, what type of human are you? And it used to really bother me. Like, why does this matter so much to people to know this information? But I think it's because we find categories really comforting. So this is an excerpt from the book The Sympathizer by Viet Thanh Nguyen. And the main character in this book, he's mixed race, he's Vietnamese and white American. And this is a scene where a white American professor of, I think it's a professor of Asian American studies or something like that, is asking him to think about himself and to list what characteristics of himself are either Occidental or Oriental. And it's a really funny list, and I have gotten questions about me to do things like this before, so it's a funny list, it's very real. But it also kind of speaks to this need for people to have this categorization and to have characteristics and parts of our identity have a clear racial provenance. And for mixed race people, I don't think that anybody can really do this, but especially for mixed race people, it's not possible to divvy ourselves and our personalities and our identities into neat columns like the previous slide. So rather than neat columns, I often feel a lot more like this. So many of us have probably heard the phrase before that race is a social construct. And when you're mixed, this is really obvious because your race can change by the minute depending on who you're with or what you're wearing, how your hair is cut, what people are expecting of you. And so people tell me all the time what I am depending on what they need me to be or want me to be. And my race is also often used as an explanation for why I exhibit certain in-group characteristics or behaviors. But also it's used as proof of my otherness. So one way that this comes out when people are saying these kinds of things to me is in reference to my blood. So in many cultures, blood is used to represent familial or cultural connection. And it's used as kind of a synonym for belonging. So in English, we say things like blood relatives or blood ties, and we're talking about like a really close, direct connection between people. And in Korea, in Korean, blood is used more generally to speak about race. So in Korea, there's this idea of a one blood people. And it's this idea that all Korean people are descended from a common ancestor. And as I started researching this, like this is a concept that is fairly prevalent in Korea. And when I was starting to research the connection between blood and Koreanness, I was surprised to find out that it's actually a pretty modern concept. It was popularized or kind of came into the intellectual sphere in the early 1900s as a reaction to Japanese colonial occupation. So the Japanese were really pushing this idea of pan-Asianism, which is basically that Japanese, Koreans, and Chinese people are all of the same East Asian race. And so this kind of idea of a one-blood people or a distinct Korean identity was in opposition and kind of a rejection of this Japanese colonial occupation. So this one blood, this idea of a one blood people, the one result of that is that oftentimes Koreans feel more of an affinity, so Koreans in Korea, I mean, feel more of an affinity to Korean Americans than they do to a mixed race person like myself, or to the children of immigrants who may have been born and raised in Korea. So this is a still from a video about this Korean model. His name is Hyun Min, the model in the middle. And I thought that this caption was really interesting because Hyun Min isn't a foreigner, he's Korean. But this kind of idea of like this Koreanness being really closely tied to race and this idea of ethno-nationalism has been changing with a younger generation, but there's still a lot of discrimination that are faced by people who don't look typically Korean. So what I was wondering when I was starting to make these batteries, if a pure-blooded Korean person, no matter where they were raised or whatever about them, if they were more Korean than a mixed-blood Korean person, if I could create a pure-blooded Korean machine, would that machine be more Korean than me? And more generally, what I was wondering is, can electronic systems take on the identities of the blood that's giving them life? Is it possible for us to feel kinship with a blood-powered LED? And does it change if we know that that blood is coming from a relative or from someone of the same racial group? So this is my first battery. And in this one, I was really had a more of an interest and a stronger emphasis on the circuitry on top rather than the form of the battery. And I thought that maybe I could create more of a feeling of sympathy if I made this like circuit more interactive, and I'm taking a very liberal definition of the word interactive here, by having the circuit kind of do something other than just be a light. So I decided that I wanted it to blink because it was kind of reminiscent of a heartbeat, but it wasn't too in your face or it wasn't, you know, too attention grabbing. So you kind of would walk into a room and you'd see this thing in the corner and it's just kind of blinking quietly. And I thought it created this nice, like inviting kind of quiet object. So this is a close up of the circuit that's on top. I'm not sure if you can really see that, but. What I wanted to do when I made this circuit was to break all the components of this blinking light down to the very essential parts. So I didn't want to use a microcontroller. I didn't want to do anything too complicated. I wanted to be as little abstraction as possible. And just as I was exposing the biological component by having the blood be so visible like this, I also wanted to expose the electronic components by having that circuit be open. And in some way, I was hoping that this would make it seem more vulnerable and maybe more sympathetic. But ultimately, I didn't really like this form. I thought it still didn't really feel very human, that it was very clinical, this kind of like vials with the blue rubber stoppers, and then this spider-looking thing on top was, you know, still felt very foreign. It didn't feel very human. So the next thing that I did was think a little bit more about the form. So this is kind of a classic design of a voltaic pile, which was the first electric battery that Alessandro Volta made back in 1800, or is inspired by the design. His battery was not like this. but it's basically, instead of having the electrodes be in separate vials and having them connected by a wire, you collapse them together so they're just touching each other. And then your electrolyte, which for me is blood, is kind of stacked in between. And so the way that he did it when he made his voltaic pile as Alessandro Volta was to use pieces of cardboard soaked in brine. So I kind of thought about using like cloth or cardboard to soak my blood, but I didn't like the thought of introducing more ingredients into this system. So what I did instead was make blood jello. And this freed me to make much more sculptural forms. And what I realized as I was making this is it's not just the concept of the blood that makes us feel kinship. It's also the appearance. So just like it's important that Hyun Min and myself don't look the way somebody expects a Korean person to look, it's important that that previous battery doesn't look at all human. So I wanted the form itself, when you first saw it, to be something that you could feel some sort of a closeness to. And I created this kind of like this curved form because I wanted it to look like a figure that was bending over and maybe, you know, I don't know, contemplative. Oh, the last part is this light that I kept in each system. So a battery is a battery regardless of whether or not it has anything connected to it. When you have a bunch of AA batteries in your drawer, you still call them batteries. But I didn't want it to just be this pile of electrodes. I wanted it to be connected to the light so that it was really clear that this is functioning and that this is alive. So this next one is called Family Portrait, and you may have seen this in the invite that went out. And in this one, I had actually had the thought for this before I created the solid, oh, so the last one was called Solitary Figure, this is Family Portrait. And I had this idea first, because I knew that I wanted multiple batteries in conversation. And it was what I was thinking about when I had this idea of, like, I really want to create a family portrait of these blood batteries, and what would that look like? Part of it was because that family portraits are really important for illustrating blood ties. And especially for mixed race people, family portraits are kind of a way to prove your racial authenticity. So when you Google a mixed race, a famous mixed race person, like when you start typing in Meghan Markle or something, one of the first autocompletes is almost always parents or mom or dad. But people need to be able to see that connection and to see why this person looks like this and how they're connected, what that racial provenance is, so to speak. So that's kind of what I was thinking about in this system, is like, how can I create this family portrait that is clearly a system that is all connected? And so part of what I did here is that neither of these stacks of batteries is functional on its own. In order for the light to light up, you can't just attach it to one or the other, and I didn't want there to be this cluster of batteries, each with their own light. I wanted them to actually be electrically connected, so the light needs to be connected to both. So this next one has two titles. It's called Jungle and The Leftovers. So the other batteries that I made were planned. I sketched them out, I tested the different components, I made sure everything worked the way I wanted it to. This one was totally haphazard how it came about. And what happened was after I finished those other batteries, I had all of this leftover blood jello. I didn't want to waste it because blood is hard to come by. So I was like, what can I do with this giant oval patty of blood? And I thought I would slice it up and kind of stack it together so that it would look like this tongue. And I really like this idea of it being a tongue, because a follow-up question I often get to what are you is when I say, Korean, is that, do you speak Korean? Is like almost always the very next question. And so I liked kind of thinking about this connection between, you know, culture and race and also language. And it's interesting to ask this question because, you know, I guess my thought would be, is my answer to that question, if I say yes or no, does that change how you think of me? Does that change what race I am? That's kind of the reaction I would get from English speakers. When I talk to Korean speakers, people sometimes say things like, oh, you speak Korean because it's in your blood. And I thought that phrasing was really interesting. Like, how is it that language or my liking of Korean food or whatever it may be, how is this a trait that's carried in my blood? And I just kind of like that image of it being something that's sitting in my blood and kind of like getting passed down and expressing itself. And so the last thing is that I wanted to give this piece two separate titles, Jjampong and The Leftovers. So Jjampong, the Korean title, refers to this seafood soup, which is kind of like a bunch of different seafood ingredients tossed in a pot together, but it's also a derogatory term for a mixed person. And then the second title, The Leftovers, is just the English title, is just a direct reference to the process, that it was a bunch of leftovers that I threw together. And this is kind of an acknowledgement that maybe there's multiple audiences to this. And that maybe if you're approaching this as somebody who speaks Korean or thinks of themselves as Korean or is Korean, that you might have a different connection to it or reaction to it than if you're an English speaker. I guess the very last point about the form here is that I also wanted to like create these divisions in this category. Like just like in the synthesizer, how there are these like categories, I wanted to take this tongue and dissect it and to categorize it. And so that's kind of why I placed the glass in between like this. But I also left the tops jagged because I didn't want it to be too clinical. I thought if they were rectangular, they would look too much like slides, and that I didn't want to go back to that kind of lab look. I wanted to make sure that it still looked organic. So this one, I wanted to show this because this is what the electrodes look like underneath that tongue. And it was kind of an interesting process because, you know, it was interesting to figure out how to shape the electrodes to make this battery actually function. But also, I kind of created these teeth, and it was became this like violent act to like shove the blood patty down onto these teeth to make sure that it would stick in the way that I wanted it to stick. And it's kind of reminiscent of how it's emotionally violent to be categorized and dissected in that way. So this is actually a fail, but I wanted to show it anyway because it's kind of a contrast to the next one. But this was after making that when I was like, oh, I could use the electrodes as a medium as well. Like, it's not just the blood in the form of the blood. Maybe I could create more interesting patterns or something with the electrodes. So blood and resin don't really play nicely, so I'm still kind of figuring this out. But this is kind of one direction that I'm taking it, is thinking about like if there are like cultural or other patterns that I could shape the electrodes into that might make you feel some kind of connection or sympathy with it instead of pushing the like human form. So this is the last one I'm going to show, and it's the exact opposite of pushing the patterns and the electrodes. This one is just like human looking. So what I wanted to do with this one here is I created this face, and I cast a face to do it, but when you cast a face, you're supposed to put on like plaster bandages or something so that the shape of the mold stays in a shape of a face, like almost like there's a skeleton there, but I didn't do that. So I let the face just kind of collapse. And the reason I wanted to do this is because I didn't want this to be recognizable as a particular person. I wanted it to be clearly human and something that we could feel a visceral connection to, but I didn't want people to get hung up on figuring out who this was. So that's kind of it for the batteries that I wanted to show tonight. And my batteries and my work in general, what I'm interested in exploring are these kind of moral gray areas. And I want to do this by creating objects that make people feel uncomfortable. So I would ask about those batteries, do you think those batteries are human? And if not, why not? Ounce for ounce, they might have more human in them than they have non-human in them. So why is it that we draw our lines in certain places and not in other places? Why is it that we categorize people in one group versus another? So that's kind of what I wanted to leave you with. Oh, and then this here is a quote from an artist that I really love, Adrian Piper. And she talks a lot in this essay that she wrote, she talks about how we have these certain beliefs about the world, and that it's through being made to feel uncomfortable that we question and perhaps change some of our beliefs. And so that's kind of what I was hoping to do with the batteries, is to make people feel uncomfortable and maybe make them question about how they put people into categories of race or whatever.